10 seconds remaining.
Hello, and welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to a Beyond the Summer presentation of the WPC Ace League. This is Orange Esports versus CIS Game. Here, the second game of the best of two series. Game one went the way of CIS. Orange Esports went for a very greedy lineup, and CIS, on pretty much on all fronts, were able to punish them for it. Like, the Viper did find the farm there, but it's a Viper. He can only do so much, and with overwhelming loss of the other two lanes as well as the jungle, they just were on the wrong foot to move forward into the greedy mid to late game. So they get pinned down and CIS take it away. Now we're going to see what they bring to the table in game two. Thanks for sticking with me here on Beyond the Summit. I am Blaze, if you guys don't recognize my voice. And I'm filling in for the members that couldn't be here. Either Gods is not feeling that well, or the other guys are, you know, hard prepping for the North American Hub qualifier actions. They're going to be hard at work over the next couple days, but they decided to take it easy tonight and get some very heavy sleep. Anyways, we're going to be looking at the early stage of the draft here and look at both sides. It looks to be pretty standard. Orange is going to be banning out the Batrider and Invoker as they do not have first pick available, but leaving open the Ancient Apparition to be picked up for the second time this series. So Ember Spirit and Lycan, pretty standard bans as well, though I honestly don't think that Ember is as big of a threat as he used to be. Still, it's worth the ban or the pick sometime in the early stages. I just don't know if he's first ban compared to some alternatives, especially with Orange. Ysera, he doesn't run Ember Spirit nearly as often as a couple of other key mid pickups, and those heroes generally are better at controlling the game as a whole. Remaining. We may see once again the Viper come through. It's a pretty good pickup against AA just to out-sustain. Or they might just be able to find a situation where Xoxes can actually get farm on a hero like Weaver. All remains to be seen though. For now, we're just gonna speculate as we get into just the first phase of the draft. I'd like to thank you guys once again for tuning in here at Beyond the Summit. Whether you guys are having a splendid evening in the Eastern Hemisphere, whether you guys are just waking up in Europe or are sticking it out long night with me in the North American scene. It looks like I'm going to be pretty much pulling an all-nighter. I've got a best of three after all my ace coverage, so it is just going to be, it was kind of a spontaneous pickup, but I'm happy to be able to bring you guys these games. Make sure that we do have some casting coverage of them. So anyways, Centaur is going to be the initial pickup. We saw some good play from Winter on that previously, and he doesn't want to go without an offlane option. Winter generally kind of rotates between three or four different heroes on the offlane. He certainly can play the others, it just isn't as frequent. He plays Clockwork, Centaur, Batrider, Darkseer most prevalently. And is gradually adjusting to make sure that he has a wide enough pool, but if you get the opportunity to pick up the Centaur, why the hell not? They're going to follow it through again with the Dazzle. So they do have a lot of potential to deal with the early Ice Blast, but I think they need to bring the pressure to CIS, because CIS essentially are just looking for a mirror match. They're saying, okay, rerun of game one, absolutely fine by us. In this case, I don't think Orange is going to make the same mistake of picking up a Jungle Doom for Insidious C. It was just far too greedy. They didn't actually have any real support or lane control, and they just got run over. So I think they'll kind of nix on that one, but maybe they'll be able to put some pressure on this AA, and that's important. Obviously, we saw how great the Aghanim Scepter was, guaranteeing kills left and right, even when the AA remaining was only level 10. So, going to be even more prevalent if you can get that early momentum, but it's Orange's job to stifle that, and if they can get the early blink out on Centaur, if the Dazzle is very skilled in his usage of his spells, they certainly have the tools to do that. For now, though, Lifestealer are going to be played, I believe, by June again. Black used to play it a lot in the Western scene, but most recently has been picking Radiant up the solo mid-roll, so switching up the roles a little bit, making sure that they're on par for future games. But for now, we're going to see the banning phase come through. Triumph Protector taken out by CIS, as well as the Slark, just in case Sox is wanting to go that route. And then from there, Puck is going to be taken out by Orange, worried about that combination of Dream Coil and Ice Blast. And they do really want to make sure that their mid lane is pretty well controlled. That was the one lane they won last time around. Ysera did a really good job with that. He didn't dominate the mid, but he got his farm. And that was what he was looking for. So maybe we'll see a similar pickup. They want to make sure that they have at least an even matchup for him so that they can kind of snowball off of that. If not there, I have absolutely no idea where, because Soxys is one of those aggressive carry players that he is going to be fighting whether he gets early farm or not. But whether or not they have the backup depends on when the Centaur gets the blink and when Ysera is really starting to make his mark on the map. We will see the Mirana picked up once again. Last time around, it was in the hands of Ayo and played supremely well. Some great Moonlight Shadows, some even better early game arrows, and he was able to make such a huge impact in the early stage. Zoned out the Doom, controlled, and got some good kills, and that's what we're going to be looking for again, this time in the hands of Orange. Maybe with the setup of a hero remaining. Like Shadow Demon. The problem right now is CIS cannot... I don't know, maybe they could draft a Shadow Demon for themselves. I bet they're even thinking about it, because Ancient Apparition Shadow Demon isn't too bad, and Shadow Demon... Dazzle against a, and as well as a Mirana up against a Lifestealer, it's a very difficult position to stay in because you just disrupt somebody that's not Lifestealer. I mean, you can disrupt Lifestealer, but you have to time the arrow so perfectly. You have to put it on top of the Shadow Ball as it concludes its banishment, otherwise he's just going to rage out of it. So Shadow Demon can choose his target, disrupt the Lifestealer, disrupt somebody else, but the bottom line is disrupt into arrow, into Shadow Wave, and that's a dead hero. They're going to pick up the Lich. Control some Creepilibrium, get some cool team fights going. Hopefully we don't get some epilepsy from some Agaballs, but more likely he's just going to be making a supportive impact and not really going to be able to farm as directly. Shadow Demon still seems like the prime pick for me, though. You get the Demonic Purge versus Nyx, you get to control the lanes so much more effectively, and it still is on the board. I just hope that Orange doesn't go for greed again. If they do go for greed, I think that's going to be kind of sealing their fate right there and then. I don't like to call games by the draft, but they have such great early aggression, they need to follow through with that. And they're going to follow through with an Enchantress. So we've got Winter running on the Centaur on the off lane. That is going to be on the bottom lane for the Dire. Dazzle's going to be supporting their carry up top. Maybe the Mirana, may not be. And then Enchantress, of course, is going to be roaming about the jungle, farming, ganking, pushing. The Mirana, of course, like I said, is flexible. She can run on the solo mid lane or make her way to farm as a carry. SEA really favors carry Mirana. They really do. They love to go in Lincoln's Rush on her put out the right-click pressure after the fact with hard aggression items.
5 seconds remaining.
CIS, they have a lot of nuke, they have some good slows, but they don't have any hard stuns. Cold Snap does not count, guys. Does not. Cold Feet, I mean. Shoot. Getting my words mixed up already. It's only 4:15 in the morning by me, and I'm going to be going for like 3 more hours at least. So hopefully I'm not saying the wrong spells left and right. But Chaos Knight is going to bring them some hard stun, that is for sure. I'm not sure how they're going to land this Lifestealer now. Maybe offlane, maybe 1v1 versus the Centaur. I think that would be really cool. So he'll run on the safe lane, and they could go for Acro Try? I don't know. One thing I will mention is that when Chaos Knight first came out in Dota 2, he was laned very frequently with both Lich, Ancient Apparition, and Lina remaining. In dual lanes. Later on, they added Venomancer to that, but Veno doesn't put out crap for damage. So I would say CK Lich could be a great dual mid. Also, CK Ancient Apparition would be perfectly fine. So we'll see exactly what they opt for, but if they want to put Lifestealer in the safe lane and run a kind of 1-2-2 setup, that could be perfectly fine. And then it's going to put pressure on Insidious C to have to smoke gank very actively to control that mid, because you're getting your lane pulled back by Sacrifice, and you walk into the lane, you're going to be nuked down hard. Might not kill you, but it certainly won't make you stronger. It's going to really hurt with this Chaos Bolt and Frost Blast.
Radiant team ban.
I actually don't even think they need a Wisp here. People consider Chaos Knight only viable when he's a symbiote to that amazing hero, the lovely ball of blue, but it is not going to be necessary here. In fact, I think it would weaken their lineup as a whole. Global presence, great. Chaos Knight plus Wisp, very strong. But right here, right now, all they want to do is bring some hard right-click damage and control the lanes very effectively. Last time it worked well. If it's not broken, don't fix it. They're going to dominate lanes if they run the lineup kind of similar to what I said. Lifesteal Ancient Apparition bottom, Lich CK mid, and then a solid offlaner to seal the deal. Orange Esports Contemplative. It's a very difficult position to draft into. They banned out the Furion.
Remaining.
In turn, the Viper was banned out against them. And that was probably one of the few heroes that could sustain remaining. Against Lich CK, as far as those hard nukes go.
Reserve
I don't know
time.
At this point. Pick Omni Knight. I don't have any clue what would do well in Lich CK's land. I mean, you can't pick up something that's too experience reliant. You can't pick up something that's too squishy to hard nukes. It's difficult. Pick up Meepo. He's got some good magic resistance. Oh, he's just gonna be completely shattered by the AA Lich ultis. Oh, and then can you imagine a fully phantasmed reality rift on a Meepo?
Radiant team
it just
pick.
Hurts to even think about. You cringe. But they're going to pick up the Templar Assassin, like I said, somebody not too vulnerable and can do well if they're getting most of the experience but not all of it. I think that's a really solid pick, and it's something that Ysera has played a couple times. In fact, Ysera's probably one of the better players at playing from behind in a matchup. If he goes in and says, I'm a TA up against a Viper, he still does okay in the lane, and then one gank and he's on top of the world. So we'll see if the rotations are on point. They certainly have the tools to make these ganks happen. It just comes down to execution. In the meantime, like I said, CIS probably looking for an offlaner. They've got 4 seconds to decide. They're going to go with Timbersaw, and that is going to be certainly making some waves in those situations. Now, Timbersaw can go in the offlane perfectly fine against Centaur, but like I said, I think Centaur is going to be bottom and Timbersaw most likely just going to try to survive against Dazzle Mirana on the top. Though it's going to be June, and we have seen in the Asian scene a lot more frequently carry Timbersaws. Seems silly, actually turns out to be pretty kick-ass. You get a 10-minute Bloodstone on anyone, they're going to do work, but Timbersaw, he's one of those heroes that astonishingly potent when he gets that farm. And, of course, that allows the supports to roam a lot. Ancient Apparition Lich can put pressure on mid, whatever they want to do. But it comes down to how Black runs the Lifestealer. If he's looking for the 1v1 against Centaur, if he's looking for free farm lane supported by his allies, it could go any number of ways. But still an interesting setup that we're going to see Black again on the Lifestealer, and this time June's picking up Timber. Orange's lineup, very easy to predict their lanes as well as their heroes. CIS, not so much. So we'll see exactly what they have in mind. Though it looks like it might be it's going to be a traditional safe lane, Timbersaw, and aggressive tri-lane from CIS. So again, Timbersaw's one of those heroes that's really good against Centaur 1v1 as well, and that's because of Whirling Death. A hero that relies so much on high strength gain as well as base strength is going to be just torn asunder when you get that Whirling Death on him a couple times over. So that's what we're going to look at. I'm going to change one thing on my overlay real quick, and then we'll get underway with the intros. There we go. Anywho, going to be looking at some early movement from CIS and Orange, and let's get into introductions before things get a little too active. Looking over the side of CIS here, this is game 2 of the best of 2 series here in WPC Ace, part of a triple header for Orange. They've got a long night ahead of them. Let's see if they can pull out a win to move them with some psychological momentum into the next match. For now, introducing CIS. With the worst effect of showcase view, I'm just going to avoid that for now. Alright, so we've got June running on the safe lane solo Timbersaw. We've got Inflame running on the Chaos Knight. In the mid lane, looks like to be supported by Ayo on the Ancient Apparition. That leaves Black to play the Lifestealer, combining forces with the Lich. Waiting a little bit on his sacrifice, but he'll get there. And he is being played by Demons. This is going to be Xoxus playing on the Carry Mirana on the safe lane here, going for an early Basilius. Ysera, of course, is going to take up the Bottle Rush opportunity with a pooled Tango on the mid lane. Not an easy lane, but he'll do what he can. We're going to see some roaming support action from Insidious C and Sharky. This is the Radiant Jungle, of course, so putting pressure out here will actually change the pace of the game quite significantly. There's a lot more tempo required when you kind of park it in the enemy's turf. At least that's what I've learned from Breaking Bad. Anyways, Winter's going to be the last hero to introduce. He is playing the Centaur, and he's going to be trying to farm up that Blink Dagger quickly, but like I said, one point of Willing Death, and this lane becomes pretty difficult for him to win. In the meantime, though, they're going to just be kind of dual jungling right here on the Radiant side, and they're going to be cleaning that up with some good AoE utility. Not going to find any kills for a while, though. Not with a Satyr. Hellbear might actually set them up, though. I actually do think it would have been the Lich on the mid lane instead of the Ancient Apparition if it wasn't for the fact that their opponent is TA. TA has too many charges for her refraction to burn through that a Frost Blast would be almost useless. So being able to instead sub in Cold Feed Ancient Apparition would just allow them to burn through for some better initial damage. We do see a flank to gank, not smoked up, but still walking in. They've got the Hadouken Shockwave, but they're not casting anything. One Shockwave will come out. Hellbear Smasher, pretty much useless. In fact, just throwing out the clap now. Doing some damage to the Satyr. Wow, that's a lot of mana committed, bro, in Flame. He just used 200 mana to kill a Satyr that was dead in 10 seconds anyways. I have absolutely no idea what a Satyr did to his family, but he apparently is having none of that. That is absolutely absurd. Anyways, Isera, with three charges of refraction, it will be burned through pretty hard with this cold feet, but he just gets to walk away, bottle back up, and Inflame has absolutely no follow-through for obvious reasons. Making their way back downtown, walking fast, faces past. They're headed for Timbersaw. He has boots first, though, so he's going to be able to survive no problem at all. They really just don't have any long-range lockdown. They're walking back and forth, trying to put control over both lanes and essentially getting control over neither, other than essentially mana burning in flame three times over. But yeah, we're going to see 1 point of poison touch, 1 point, of course, an enchant. They try to slow, they try to gank, but there is really no kill potential without like something like a Dark Troll Summoner. Now we're going to be diving past the lane here. There's going to be a Radiant's weird creep equilibrium shift as the tower starts dealing damage to the dire creeps, starting with the Satyr Tormentor. But back in mid lane, we're going to see some big damage. Haste Rune, will it be enough? Isera will get out of the cold feet. Delivered some walloping damage to the CK, even under the Ancient Apparition's protection. Now bringing in the Centaur, Radiant's some nice attack speed boost to try to bring down this tier 1 as quickly as possible. We'll see if they get the opportunity. So. Black, what you doing? So, they pause the game, they win TI, apparently. MUFC rebound. I don't know, but yeah, we're gonna get some experience advantage from this top lane here. Oh, it looks like a DC issue from Black. He needs to come back in just a moment here. Anyways, double sacrifice here, giving them the nice experience gains. Rana's still finding some, but it's not nearly as much as she wanted. Only level 3 right now. It's kind of a repeat of what we saw game 1. Soxus gets put on the, like, in the safe lane on a hero that has a great escape, but just through better lane control, CIS is keeping him completely shut down. But at the same time, they are putting pressure here on Timbersaw. 1-1-1. It's not a surprise for June to be under some pressure, though. Signing himself up for the safe lane, he probably expected to be a little less. At least no first blood taken out. That's still on the table. Dyer's Centaur will come in, but he's got his Timber Chain. There is no way they finish him off. They're going to do some good damage. There's the stun. There's the double edge. But June is still regening. He has 6 charges of magic stick, but we'll probably have to use them. One more Timber Chain, he's gone. But forcing him away from the tower, they will put even more damage into this tier 1. Inflame low on mana, but now has that bottle up. Will be enough to get him a couple more stuns out on this lane. And they can go ahead and crow it if they so choose with the brand new International Compendium Courier. This too could be yours for the low price of $9.99. I don't even know what it's called, but it's a parrot, and it's pretty cool. Sir Squawkins or something, I forget. Polly, I don't know. Anyways, so a lot of paused Dota coming out. Obviously some technical issues on the sides of CIS. Black is back in the game, but is still waiting it out. So extended gold graphs looks to be deceiving because it's only 3.5 minutes with about 2 minutes straight of pauses. But in the end, we'll see what comes up. For now though, we're going to be seeing Sentry Ward pressure being put on the mid in case Isera tries to try to escape with the meld. Usually would be a time saver for him because even Cold Feet can't break him out of it. It's not a channel like Sandstorm, but even still, they drop the sentry down. That's going to be time he's wasting while he gets hit on hard by this CK. Who is going for a little bit of an interesting build here, Reality Rift over Chaos Bolt. I don't know if that's the new build since the inversion of Chaos Bolt's damage and stun. Essentially, it's a more reliable ability, but it has lower potential. It used to have the potential of doing crazy stun and crazy damage, and now it's a little bit of one and a lot of the other. So I don't know if the build now is Reality Rift is just always better, or if that's a personal preference, because we haven't seen that much of Chaos Knight in the metagame in a very long time. But I'm gonna take Inflame's word for it, and I'm gonna assume that he actually did try this out and test this out in multiple games previously. Either way, this is a great way for Ancient Apparition to get level 6. The fact that he has no excuse but to get 50% EXP from the lane constantly. There are 6 denies coming in from Isera, but it's not going to prevent him from leveling up very rapidly to find that ultimate. He'll be sharing that experience directly with the CK. In the meantime, June can handle it. He's one of those guys that can take a lot of hits here, especially once he gets that second point in reactive armor. But for now, just getting that HP regen, some tangos, some salves, he'll be back up to snuff in no time. And it was very smart of him to pick up that magic stick as well. He started off with Stout Shield, went for the boots immediately, and then was able to find a magic stick while Orange was roaming about. If they had actually started putting pressure on him before that magic stick, who knows what could have happened. They really could have actually gotten a good kill, but some of it does come down to RNG. We look at the jungle, and there haven't been that great of spawns. They're not really taking good care of it because it's not their jungle, but they grab up a centaur, they make it do work, and you see that they brought June down pretty low. Obviously not getting the kill, two centaurs insufficient, but they didn't really have much choice. Like, the Wolf Commander aura is great later, but not really that contributional now. And they've all otherwise been dealing with Hellbears and Satyrs. Not the most gank-oriented spawns, unless the enemy is willing to walk right into them. The only really good ganking creep that's spawned before that centaur and Hellbear is the Dark Troll Summoner, and it's all the way to the west where they haven't even ventured to this point. And just since we have plenty of time on our hands, let's take into comparison the Radiant Jungle. If they'd started there, they've got a Hellbear here, they've got a centaur there, and we see a pull coming out for the centaurs over here. But this is three great creeps they could have taken advantage of, but it's just the way the game spawns sometimes, and they get RNG'd out of some early tempo. Still, no kills. First blood available. And I honestly, it just comes down to who makes the first mistake. There's not enough kill potential to completely outplay an opponent and bring them down. It's just going to be some opponent making that mistake. Morana getting in a position where she can't leap away. The TA getting in a position where she can get stunned out and pulled back into the lane pretty hard now that CK can bottle up. And of course, there is plenty of kill potential on the Timbersaw, but he in turn has enough survivability to match it. So, a lot committed from these supports. The end result is that Orange is going to be leading on gold because of this early tier 1 tower pick, but they're going to be trailing on experience, which will favor, I think, CIS because of the fact their ultimates are so potent. You give a Lich Chain Frost, he's going to want some milk to go with. I mean, he's going to beat the crap out of people. I don't even know if people read to give a Moose a Muffin anymore. It was a childhood staple of mine, but kids these days probably all read e-picture books, don't you? I don't know. I'm really just trying to think of things to say at this point, if that's not completely clear. Because we have been paused for a very large amount of time. And usually what I do when I get paused for a really large amount of time in SCA Dota, which is like completely, like every other game is like that. It's nefarious for that, I suppose, but that's another word I'm looking for. But what I like to do, since we do have these disconnects, is look at the hero lore. So let's look at what heroes we're looking at. We got Timbersaw, CK, Lifestealer. So we'll start with those, if this builds up well enough. No, I'm not going to go over my compendium predictions. They're probably crap. Also, it's kind of weird that they only work for the European qualifier, at least if I'm reading that correctly. I just kind of feel weird only voting for one qualifier for matches that, I don't know, they're a little cut and dry compared to some of the other qualities. Like, SEA and Chinese qualifiers are going to be really close, but Europe and NA, there's either going to be some major upsets or they're going to be a little bit chalk. Anyways, I was looking for Timbersaw. He's over here. Let's check out some lore. I'm by no means a voice actor, so if you hate my voice, this is not going to be the segment for you, but I'm just killing time. And what better way than to check out Valve's amazing story writing. Rizorak could still hear the screams in his mind. He worked, frantically turning wrenches, twisting screws, building and carving and forging. Sleep eluded him. He only built. Months and months passed since he had shut himself in his uncle's workshop, and his deliverance was nearly complete. He rubbed his back as his eyes drifted shut and saw a blanket of flowers floating on the placid waves of Augury Bay before exploding into a cloud of pollen that silenced lives as it seized the lungs. Nice. He woke with a choking start. For hours, the rhythmic sound of a whetstone filled the shop as he sharpened a set of massive blades. His mind filled with images of strangling vines, corroding neighbors, and wrapping homes. The flooding of Augury Bay had been nothing compared to the violent horrors the waters left to take root beyond the city walls. But the sawsuit would make him strong and safe, he thought. I'm getting so distracted by you guys. Allowing him this sliver of hope before the full of might of his fear crashed into his fading mind. Branches and bark and blood. When the city fell, Rizrak fled trees that walked and fought and killed. Trees had shattered the gates and swarmed into the city. Trees had crushed and thrashed and stomped the last that Augury Bay could muster in defense. and stalked the few fleeing refugees. In addled silence, Rizrak unspooled the thick chain from the suit's arm, his hands quaking as he inspected each link and ran a trembling finger along the claw attached at its end. The saw suit was ready. He was Iron Man. With his hand trembling, he sparked the bladed machine to life. Terror drove him, terror of what awaited him and of what he would have to face to have any hope of calming his mind. As the saw suit shuddered to life, he knew he must face his fear, and he knew he wouldn't like it one bit. Good times. So, we still have the pause going on. Black Dodo, having some trouble. I have to play some AC/DC upon his return, apparently, but for now, waiting it out, making sure they have all the technical issues worked out, because they do want to give their all for this game, and Ping Dodo is not going to be working for them in this scenario. But, until then, let's kill some more time. CK it is. These guys have the best, like, the strongest lore, just because fundamentals are OP, even if it's not that interesting. The veteran of countless battles on a thousand worlds, Chaos Knight hails from a far upstream plane where the fundamental laws of the universe have found sentient expression. Of all the ancient fundamentals, he is the oldest and most tireless, endlessly searching out a being he knows only as the Light. Long ago, the Light ventured out from the progenitor realm? In defiance of the First Covenant, now Chaos Knight shifts from plane to plane, always on the hunt to extinguish the Light wherever he finds it. A thousand times he has snuffed out the source, and always he slides into another plane to continue his search anew. Upon his steed Armageddon he rides, wading into battle with maniacal frenzy, drawing strength from the disorder of the universe, a physical manifestation of chaos itself. In times of need, he calls upon other versions of himself from other planes, and together these dark horsemen ride into battle, as unstoppable as any force of nature. Only when the last light of the world is scoured from existence will the search be ended. Where rides the Chaos Knight? Death soon follows. Also, he might be the strong nuclear force, or weak, or whatever. People debate that a lot. The only one people know is Io. Anyways. Pause Dota persists. There's really nothing to talk about in game. The graphs have started lying to you, and soon enough, I'll be blathering on enough that I'll have to lie to you too. So we go for Lifestealer. The shitty wizard himself. I'm also out of water, so if my voice sounds dry, you have your reason. Dun 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 dun. I'm making a lot of friends, guys. I'm so popular. Where are we going? We're going Lifestealer. I'm trying to see how to spell or pronounce that, but I'll just make it up. In the dungeons of Divark, a vengeful wizard lay in shackles, plotting his escape. He shared his cell with a gibbering creature known as Naix, a thief cursed by the Vile Council with longevity. So that it's life sentence for the theft and cozening. This is a lot of words I'm bad at. Cozening, I'll have to Google that. But theft and cozening might be as punishing as possible. Over the years, its chains had corroded along with its sanity. Naix retained no memory of its former life and no longer dreamt of escape. Seeing a perfect vessel for his plans, the wizard wove a spell of infestation and cast his life force into Naix's body, intending to compel Naix to sacrifice itself in a frenzy of violence while the mage returned to his body and crept away unnoticed. Instead, the wizard found his mind caught in a vortex of madness so powerful that it swept away his plans and shattered his will. Charged to consciousness by the sudden infusion of fresh life, Naix woke from its nightmare of madness and obeyed the disembodied voice that filled its skull, which had only the one thought, to escape. In that moment, Lifestealer was born. The creature cast its mind into dungeon guards and soldiers, compelling them to open locks and cut down their companions, opening an unobstructed path to freedom while feeding on their lives. Lifestealer still wears the broken shackles as a warning that none may hold him, but on the inside remains a prisoner. Two minds inhabit the single form, a nameless creature of malevolent cunning, and the master whose voice he pretends to obey. shitty wizard get wrecked. So Black's the master, but apparently he's been corrupted by the insanity and has to find his way back. Soon enough, he'll be back to escaping and killing and winning. But for now, he's disconnected, and we'll let the admins sort things out. I don't think there's been much chat. Nobody's winning TI here. And that brings us to the next one. Another pretty cool target, though. Ancient Apparition, I think, is one of the more interesting ones. People think, oh, he's just an old spirit. No, he's a badass. So you check it. Mr. Caldeer. Oh, it's shorter than I remember. Oh well. Caldeer, the ancient apparition, is an image projected from outside time. He springs from the cold, infinite void that both predates the universe and awaits its end. Caldeer is, Caldeer was, Caldeer shall be. And what we perceive, powerful as it appears to us, is but the faintest faded echo of the true eternal Caldeer. Some believe that as the cosmos ages and approaches its final moments, the brightness and power of Caldeer will also intensify, that the ancient apparition will grow younger and stronger as eternity's end draws nigh. His grip of ice will bring all matter to a stop. His image will cast a light too terrible to behold, an ancient apparition no longer. Wow, this pause is long. Like, this is absolutely ridiculous how long it's taken for them to get back into it. If you guys, real quick, have a preference on heroes, I'm just going line by line, but if you guys really want to hear a lore read by me, no matter how lame my voice may be, go ahead and tweet at me. I'm have my notifications open, twitter.com/blazecasting. Pick a hero. I'll go for first come, first serve, and then if after that, I'll pick whoever got multiple votes. But whoever's quick on their fingers will get a free pick of the next hero lore I read. Until then, we wait for people to disconnect and reconnect and disconnect and reconnect and disconnect and reconnect. And oh my gosh. This is ridiculous. Still waiting, guys, at Blaze Casting. Bring it. Phoenix. I actually don't know Phoenix's lore, at least not well. He was introduced to Dota in my last little stretches before I became Han Trash. But still certainly cool, though maybe generic. There's a lot of phoenixes out there. I wonder what the first fantasy story that involved a phoenix was. Assuming it's, like, I don't know. Something of Scandinavian lore or something, I have no idea. Where's this lore at? Seriously? I didn't know about that one. And here it is. The lore of the Phoenix. NPC_Dota_Hero_Phoenix_Bio. That is OP. That's actually hilarious. Can't cut to break and play music, unfortunately, because we are still in the middle of a VOD. But, well, there you go. Meepo is in there. Io, Tiny. Man, that freaking Phoenix lore. That one caught me off guard. I didn't know about it. I'm not going to show you guys my competing predictions because I don't know anything about what's going to happen. Plus, they're not that interesting. It's like, oh, will Rush be killed quickly? Will it not? Etc, etc. Apparently, they're playing without him. Seriously? They're calling G, but CIS. That's awkward. 4v5 would be a shame. Alright. So not too much overlap between you guys. I'll just go with whatever was asked second. And it looks like it is Slark, followed by Ogre Magi. Man, long pause is long. Actually, we just got Black in, so I'll give him a moment. If we can get into this game, I think I'd prefer to just cast Dota. I definitely more up my alley. But we'll wait. Looks like we're good. Okay, guys, back underway. Thank you guys so much for sticking with me through the extended pause. We are now jumping in to the, I'd almost say, second half of Orid versus CIS. Game 2, 3.5 minutes in, no kills on the board. Some aggressive movements, bring this tier 1 tower very low, and it looks like it will be last hit by the centaur here, if he times it. There we go. But beyond
Radiant's
that,
bottom tower
not
has
too
fallen.
Much to speak of. CK getting some farm, Lifestyle getting some farm, both topping the CS charts. But like I said, Ysera's not doing too bad. 13 for 6 is pretty solid, with only 1 point in side blades. He's not really able to get too close to the action, so every little bit he gets, that's a nice win for him. June is not really under too much pressure either. They have this Dire Observer Ward knowing that Insidious Sea is nowhere nearby. So even without a tier 1 tower here, he doesn't really feel too threatened. Though now he realizes the flanked gank is coming, and he does have to position himself a little more carefully. In the meantime, Invisible Lich, a little bit of extra damage from this Frost Blast. Will it be enough to bring him down? He cancels out the Reality Rift, and the damage instead is going to be done down bottom. Looking for the Troll and Snare already used, so he should be able to get out scot-free. No mini stun online. Oh, back in mid lane, we do see damage coming in, but only a 1 second stun. Is it enough to proc the cold feed? Yes, it is. Melded is not going to help you out against the Sentry Ward. Just inside the radius, he will be brought down. So first blood spilled by Inflame, and giving early momentum to CIS. Another wild goose chase coming in for Timbersaw. His trees are out to get him, but he is ready for them. Blacks gets some FaceTime 1v1 versus Mirana, and so he is going to be able to top out 27 for 10 in his CS count. And that means he's going to get some really early active items. Now, he's once again is not against the Ancient Apparition, so he's free to go for an armlet if he chooses, but Sanjin Yasha Drums is always a fun build-up as well. It gives him plenty of room to pursue onto Mirana at post-leap. Speaking of, Open Winds could come out here. No. Just going to keep farming. Keep their focus where it needs to be, topping out those charts. Sharky going to pop a Clarity. Might be canceled, might not be. Doesn't seem to make much of a difference either way. They're not going to be able to bring down June unless they get like the perfect creep and catch him completely off guard. Meanwhile, on top, Open Woods will come through Mirana's Leap on cooldown, and that is going to be a kill going to Lifestealer. Not only is he now on top of the last hit charts, but he is tied for the top of the KDA. So things looking really good for both Inflame and Black, and for CIS as a whole, as we see post-pause, we get some good momentum going right back their direction, especially in experience. Down bottom, June gonna take some hits. They are gonna go for the Stampede on top of him, but is it enough? Drank through double-edge, big right click. Oh, the last hit! Super range auto attack. He pretty much throws his axe at him to bring him down. Very close call, but in the end, the timber falls. And rotations are kind of forced out here. Xox has rank 2 arrow, but absolutely nothing going for him in the other lanes. He's like afraid to farm up top. He wants to make a gank happen on mid, but will this arrow connect? Gonna hit an arrow, or sorry, a creep, and Inflame almost goes for the die on the creep. He's like, thank you. You have served us well. But anyways, we're gonna see a turnaround onto Dazzle here. Shallow Grave keeps up for a moment, but one more right click and he is going to fall. Tries to heal himself, it is enough with the Centaur Stun, but Ancient Apparition will pick him off in the end. A double Centaur Stun on Inflame though. He will be the second casualty for CIS. Lich dropping low, but surviving. Inflame the only one to drop down. He centaurs. Good stomps from Insidious Sea, showing why he is a dedicated jungle player, essentially. Knows his creeps well, and is now going to try to make use of them here on the mid lane, bringing down this tier 1. They've got the attack speed aura, they've got the illusions. A lot of capital to bring this tower low, but even with the sacrifice coming out, I don't think they'll finish it here. Oh, they got the Alpha Wolf as well. Some great creeps to help out this push, but they still don't have much as far as kills go, and Blame shows his neutral hate once again with a little bit of Reality Rift action. In the meantime, Black happily farming up a storm. He's already moving in towards top of net worth charts, but surprisingly, we've also got some action from Winter. Like, he's only got one kill himself and 39 last hits, but he is topping the net worth. Am I missing something?
Dire's top tower is under attack.
That's actually interesting. I feel like that pause blew my mind, and now I don't know what I'm looking at. Why? It doesn't matter. Right now, Centaur is coming out on top, getting a little bit more gold coming out for himself, and now Lifestealer is back on top of the net worth. Just took a few creeps for himself, and he's back up there. Just, I'm so used to seeing Black on net worth charts and kind of firing up a storm. He's now 100 away of the Centaur, but that Centaur has a blink. That is a very impactful item for him. So he's going to smoke up himself. Nobody else smoked. Just trying to go for a solo play with the help of the TA. She has 1 point in meld, maxed out refraction, a lot of kill potential on either one of the heroes in mid, but it looks like the rotation's going to go bottom. Radiant Observer Ward, of course, not going to see him. In fact, giving them a false sense of security. This could be bad for Orange, or for CIS. He has Chain Frost. They, of course, have 4 points in the Timber Chains. But here comes Stampede. The Storm comes through. Double Edge brings down Demons. And now going on to June. Timber Chain number one. Is it going to be enough? Big right clicks coming through. They slow him down once again. But he still will Timber and TP. And he's gone. Sharky not having anything else to deliver. He's able to get out with a lot of heroes committed by Orange. Nevertheless, it's a nice little advantage, bringing them to the Equalizer, 3-for-3. So, Medallion again for Sharky. Really wanted to make the most of this early potential for negative armor. Of course, with the Weave, he gets some nice negative armor initially, and then it builds up over time. He has a physical damage nuke, essentially, with Shadow Wave. His dot also does physical damage, so it's not a bad pickup, and as I mentioned, it still has its defensive components as well as mana regen. But otherwise, really not much to write home about. Right now, their intended carry is trailing in net worth. Right now, he's only found himself 14 CS, he's only level 7, doesn't even have phase boots, and Black's already completed drums. So just by that comparison alone, I would say Orange is definitely not happy with where they're at. Demon's looking for a Chain Frost, but leaps away instead. At least forces the leap out, and now they're gonna be able to move back and forth on the lane.
Enchantress, let us run together.
Group up of Winter and Insidious C. A lot of kill potential between these two, but who do they focus? The double damage CK? I would say just try to bring down the Ancient Apparition before he can Ice Blast. Either way, they've got their potential initiation. No Sentry Wards on the mid. But Moonlight Shadow, there's the Stomp. Big damage coming in. Flame dropping low. Great Ice Blast. But doesn't matter the kill. The damage has been done. So, good movement there. Orange now leading in kills. And they're going to try to put some pressure to finish off this tower. No way the Ancient Apparition denies this in time. Easy, easy tower kill for Orange, and that's huge. If the deny had come through, yeah, Orange is only ahead by a small amount, easily recoverable for a carry lineup like CIS. But as it is, that's a huge boon for Orange. They're still behind on experience, but they are now pulling significantly ahead in gold. And I don't know why I was so puzzled about net worth before. Obviously, the Centaur got the tier 1 tower bottom, so that would give him a hell of a lot of gold. Anyways, now we see moving in towards a type of insight long-term for the Centaur. That's going to help out a lot against the Chain Frost, the Ice Blast, so on and so forth. But speaking of, frozen ammunition from the Internet Person does fall out on the Roche bed, but does not actually damage any of the opposition. So they're going to retreat from Roche. It was a pretty ambitious move to try to pick it up at 11 minutes anyways. Like, the Meld Strike helps, and obviously you can tank with Refraction, but you can only do so much. I think CIS are pretty much ready to rumble. They're going for double drum, which doesn't bring as much utility as it used to, because since all the nerfs of it, essentially, you're just paying for more charges for auras that you're stacking anyways, so on and so forth. But we're going to see some initiation out of June. He's very tanky, and the Chain Frost will come through, but it cancels out immediately. Is it enough to bring down Winter? Yes, with the Ice Blast, but here's the Shallow Grave to try to keep him up anyways. There's going to be the Phantasm from the CK. Finally, they bring down the Centaur, but can they bring down SXO? No! Inflame goes for the stun on Ysera. It's only 2 seconds. He's just going to sit under tower with that Refraction keeping him up. Now we see Insidious C taking some huge damage. Black and June bring him down. And also, they're able to bring down the Mirana as well. So, unfortunate losses for Orange Esports. They just don't have as strong teamfight ultimates, and they are forced back. Now they're tier 1 under some pressure here.
Middle tower is under attack.
And I'm not sure if they can bring it down, but they certainly can put some big hits into it. So we're going to see an armlet for the Lifestealer come out pretty quickly. That's going to help him a lot as far as just early damage output, some sustainability as well. And it never hurts to have an armor item against a TA. Just her delivering her Meld Strikes is pretty much the bane of Lifestealer's existence, but the armlet will help to mitigate just a small extent. Interesting skill builds coming out from both sides just a little bit here. Looking over at the Lich, he hasn't picked up a single point in Ice Armor yet. Usually you go for the 1-point Wonder Point, so you can put it on your buildings and get that nice little slow. A little bit of physical mid, but instead it's going to be damage on top. We're going to see Timbersaw crushed by this magical damage nuke. And we just see Winter's Blink doing work. I mean, he's already found himself to a early KDA of 1-1-3. Radiant's he wants to keep that momentum rolling in. Along with that, the experienced surprise supports, Sharky and Insidious C, are finally catching up to where they need to be. We're going to see Impetus come out for Enchantress very shortly. She has a very large mana pool with Id Treads and Point Booster. And then, on top of that, Dazzle
Radiant's top tower
gets
has
points
fallen.
And skills. Not necessarily the ultimate, unless he really wants it, but just any points and skills will help them in this early stage. Can I see another smoke come through? Let's see if they can make anything of it. Looking to really put this one in the bag before maybe the 20-25 minute mark. Not necessarily break base, but to force map control against CIS. Gonna be hard though, Chainfrost cooling down. They're gonna have to Moonlight Shadow in very carefully. Center War comes down, Winter Stampeding though, looking for the stun onto Demons, they get it. Can they stop the Chainfrost? Yes, the last right click will bring down the Lich and bring CIS in full retreat. Arrow is gonna connect onto AO though, locked in place. They might be able to get one more. The trap is in a great spot too. AO gonna walk over the second trap here, and this should be an easy kill, but they don't activate. Sonic Trap is in a perfect spot for Ysera, but they don't want to overstep their bounds. They don't know the positioning of the CK, and they are just going to rest on their laurels, looking over towards Roche. No, TPing home. They really don't capitalize on an opening that I think they pretty well orchestrated. Either way, kill momentum, Midas momentum. They are going to be able to take this to the mid game very efficiently, but now we see an arrow come out onto Inflame. He has regen room, but
Radiant's
not weak enough to warrant popping it just yet. Wildwood Tornado, delaying the push, but a quick stun, and they should be able to put this one down once again. Tier 1 tower dropping low, sub 300.
Is under attack.
But Phantasm committed, or is that a cancel? No, he actually Phantasm to try to right click this tower. I have absolutely no idea if that's cost effective in any capacity, but there you go, they're swinging away at it. Last right clicks will come through, and it is going to be a last hit for the CK. So,
in ulti
for a tower, I guess it's a value play. They just really want to avoid these blink stomps. If they get caught in a three-man stomp, the fight's already over. So they go in, they make it kind of a, at best, 1.5 stomp with the illusion in play. So it's going to be an Aghanim's coming out for Enchantress long term. Dazzle's just going to focus on the Force Staff. Not even looking at the option of the Mechanism. Seems like they just want Pipe. They feel Mechanism's not as valuable of a pickup when you consider the Enchantress ultimate. Speaking of, Aeon a good place to throw it out. But yeah, he's going to drop it right now. Winter going to take some big hits. I don't think he's going to die, but certainly is threatened out in black. Wants a piece of him. Open wounds, right click. The Shallow Grave, though, will keep him up, and he stampedes away. Now going to see an arrow to fly onto AO. Big hit, and he doesn't have Ice Blast. So Insidious C is going to take some damage, but tanking through a lot of it. The Nature's Attendance keeps him up for forever. Finally, the Chain Frost comes out and announces the Frost to finish off the Morana. Now Ysera in a bad spot. Still has a double damage rune. He will use it on black. Big Melt Strike comes through. They kill off the Lifestealer, and they walk away. In fact, if you want to stay and fight, Ysera is happy to try to tank and spank. He has 5 in Refraction, but doesn't stand and deliver. He lets the Dazzle get picked. That you can't really run from a CK. And in this position, it's going to be a triple kill coming out for the Chaos Knight, and a very substantial loss for Orange. I really think the double damage could have done more, but just didn't feel confident without BKB. So now early gold momentum is a bit of a wash on the lower levels, but it is very favorable for the carries on the side of CIS. They are going to be able to turn not only their farm into drums on both counts, but now this armlet coming out for black, and that means he is just going to be hammering it home and has to be taken as a very real threat. They have to focus a ton of damage on him, and since they don't have any silence, he can still go ahead and pass away. Gonna see some good Chakram damage following that Ice Blast, but it's not enough to bring anybody down. Of course, they still have the Shallow Grave as well, and now we're gonna see some damage coming in. A Stomp coming onto Inflame, and they burst down on all those Phantasm Illusions. Big damage coming in. The CK will fall, and now they look to the Lifestealer. In fact, Lifestealer looking to Insidious. They just cremate him, and are now looking for their next opening. Since you ward down, this Invis Rune, not enough to keep him alive for the moment. Black will pop the open wounds. And it looks like they will be able to get Ysera here. Big damage. The Refraction once again, but they have enough instances, they have enough slows, and they will just chase him down to the grave. Ysera, no hope to escape. And the Ice Blast will finish the job. I kind of feel like if he had just TP'd, he would have gotten out fine. Unless I'm There's no bashers or anything, so yeah, they don't really have any good stuns. Lich? Alright, Marana gonna give him a gimme. Gonna be able to leap away for the second life, but the first one, not necessary to lose, and they lost it anyways. Oh! The last right click coming in for Black. He pops a raise for the attack speed, and that armlet damage. Too strong. So they're gonna be able to get a lot of freebies out of that one. That was pretty sloppy from Orange, unfortunately. They started pretty strong, focusing down the CK, but they didn't have any follow-through after that, committing a lot of cooldowns to him. So, unfortunate losses by far, and we do see the graph. It's very shaky right now. No clear advantage one way or another until this point, where CIS pulls ahead significantly. Winter dropping down to critical HP. Luckily, not dying off to Envenom with the HP regen. But Ice Blast is only one click away. Fortunately, they don't have too much as far as map control right now. No Observer Wards in place, just the heroes providing some vision. And kind of surprised at that. They don't have any Observer Wards on any of their people. I know Aghanim's is fun, but you kind of got to go for your bread and butter instead of letting these wards stock up. Now, one thing to attest to is that there has been some control put out by Orange, but it still does not excuse the importance of Observer Wards at this stage in the game. So it's actually not going to be a pipe as I thought it would be with that Ring of Regen. He's going to turn into a Force Staff, and that does give them some better mobility. The most important aspect of it is going to be able to dodge and cancel the Chain Frost. You see the Chain Frost coming for you, you either stampede and run away, or you use that Force Staff and pull yourself away from your allies. If it only hits like one, two, or three heroes in a fight, then that is not worth the Lich pick. He's essentially a walking ice armor with a couple of basic nukes. But you let that Chain Frost bounce all 10 times, and things start to get very ugly very quickly. So the Force Staff on both the... Oh, damage coming in. Winter popping Stampede early. Ice Blast won't connect, though, and he should be fine. But yeah, I think there's a second Force Staff being built. I just have to recall on who...
Is under attack.
Dazzle. Okay, so Sharky and Winter both going for the Force Staves, hoping to be able to cancel out that Chain Frost and limit some of the damage coming out. But there's just so much potential aggression coming from CIS at this stage, where they have the mechanism, they have the urn, and they're pretty much willing to go as deep as necessary to find these kills.
Radiant's bottom
still
tower
resting on the back of
attack.
Some good Ice Blast. Ayo, probably going to be fishing for another opportunity very shortly. Back to item progression, just to make sure I'm not missing anything. Just Aghanim's and basic long-term ambitions. Nothing but a BKB, really, in the cards for CIS just yet. It's so interesting that these guys can be so close to one another and not really risking the potential that there are people lurking in the shadows. That they are very... especially, like, Winter. He could easily be killed off with the amount that are behind him, but now we're gonna see the bait is actually placed by June. Will it be enough? He'll mech himself up, and look at that Chain Frost go! Big damage coming out. Sharky just tries to TP during his grave, and it will be enough! Urn of Shadows not going to take him down. Centaur will fall, but at least they got out with one. The Chain Frost CD is 129, so was a level 1 Chain Frost. He got the level 11 after that fight, and it will be the longest CD possible for that spell. Isara picks up an Invis rune. There was some detection on the side of CIS. They do have one Sentry Ward here on Demons, but unless the TA walks right into this one, I doubt that they're going to be able to see him coming. Because again, they don't have Observer Wards in place. They don't see these wards, or these runes, until it's too late. Now, Ysera going in, BKB pop, looking for... Oh! That's just an easy Timber Chain away. The trap comes out, but they can't commit to this. BKB 10, completely whiffed. That's quite awkward indeed. Now, Sock's gonna take some damage. Big Reality Rift, pulling him in. The leap on cooldown. It's like practically a glimpse right there. The amount of range he was able to get on that. Obviously, exaggeration, but still, Ysera gonna take some hits. No BKB, no chance of escape. Winter has a great stun available, but knows that if he commits to it, he's probably just sacrificing himself as well. You don't run from a Chaos Knight. He's great at pursuit. It's in his lore, and it's in his toolkit. He's able to chase you to the ends of the earth, and then to the next one. So, Winter jumping in would have been a huge mistake. Dire's the best he could do was Force Staff the TA, attack. And just under too much pressure
Dire's
for that.
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
Tier 1 tower drops down, and Dire's things start to turn on their head fallen. Once again. CIS gaining the full advantage, and they don't look... They're going to lose it anytime soon. A Desolator on the Lifestealer. Black is ready to deliver some hard right-clicks, and with some things like Phantasm to follow through, they're looking really strong. Along with that, they've got a 10-second BKB. Their opponents do not, and that's always a nice thing to cheer about. Arrow onto Inflame. He's going to take a lot of damage here, but it might be kind of a pseudo bait if they're going to be able to try to turn this around. Isera, big melt strike. Is it not going to be enough, though? BKB once again pop, but he doesn't get the kill. There's going to be Winter picking up the Lich with the very substantial double edge, but having to blink onto Inflame to try to finish anything. We do see Black trying to bring down Sharky. Now the Stampede pops off, and the battle takes apart on two fronts. We do see Lifestealer going for the Rage TP. He will get out fine. Timbersaw not so fortunate on the top lane. So, they are able to get two in the bag, but again, pop and BKB charges. This thing is going to be down to 4 seconds before you know it. Isera is just committing a lot of his resources early. Which, I mean, is kind of what you have to do to put yourself back in the game, but it's just quite unfortunate when you see all these magical nukes and some actually really long duration disables on the board for CIS. Sox, again, an underwhelming performance so far. I don't look at this. If you guys haven't seen Orange before and you suddenly look at Sox and see his GPM the last two games and think, this guy's a terrible carry player, he can't do anything. I've talked with this guy, I've watched this guy for dozens and dozens of games, and he can absolutely put his entire team on his shoulders when the time calls for it. But these lanes have just not worked out for him, and he really is accomplishing very little here. He's essentially utility Morana with less worth than the Centaur, less than the Timbersaw. And Morana's a hero that you need gold momentum, you need an advantage in order to be able to essentially carry. Because basically she doesn't have any real steroids in her skill set other than a really good agi game. Now leaping away from the stun and is able to TP home before any damage is really received. Nice leap from Xox is gonna make it so that he can safely return home, and Winter doing the same. I think it was just farming the jungle though. Black farming up pretty effectively. Doesn't have a Midas this time around, so it's still a little bit of slow going, but we're going to see double Armlet. One on Lifestealer, one on CK, and from there they could pretty much hammer it home. They can contest every Roche that spawns from this point forward. They can go in for the kill because they have so much physical damage. One important thing to note about Chaos Knight, since a lot of people don't get to see him competitively, Armlet is really good because the active essentially applies to the Phantasm Illusions. They get 100% scaling on damage output. They take double damage, but they deal full damage. And when you consider an armlet, which you activate it, you get 25 strength, getting that bonus, it's actually incredible how much you can do. You can get 3 or 4 phantasms with an activation of your maxed ultimate, and 25 extra damage on all of them just with the active component is absolutely absurd. And of course, he can tank very effectively with that, and they can endure the fights all the more readily. Still, not many utility items for Orange, and that kind of bothers me. Like, picking up the Aghanims, I like what it brings for Insidious. He gets more attack range, he gets more impetus output, and once he hits level 11, that will really, really help with the pure output. But they don't have any mech, they don't have any pipe. Sox is slow on his Lincolns. It just kind of feels like if there's any good initiation from CIS, that these guys are going to shatter. Inflame farming again. Gonna be able to take down this camp no problem at all. Doesn't have any lifesteal, but this ice armor makes it so the only damage he's really receiving is from himself. I think Centaur's next big item pickup will be the pipe. No, he's going for Ghost Scepter just to nullify the physical damage of Lifestealer and CK. Doesn't care about the damage from the Whirling Death as well. The damage from the Lich and the Enchant Apparition. They think as long as we can cancel the Chain Frost, we really don't have to worry about magic, and from there, it comes down to the armor. It comes down to tanking through the physical output. And we'll see if they can manage. For now, though, they are running, once again, Aquila Aura and nothing else. Though, of course, the Weave certainly helps in its own right. Still rank 1, but over a handful of seconds is able to accumulate a very substantial amount of physical damage mitigation. Things are spread out, things are pretty quiet. Winter looking for a kill opportunity, but everybody's grouped up on the sides of CIS. The only exception to that is Inflame, but of course he has his BKB. He's coring out a TP or two, and they're just gonna kind of man mode down the mid lane. They've got their ice armors up. The Nakes bomb
Dire's
is
middle tower
ready
is
to go.
Under attack.
And Roche has just respawned.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Sox will go ahead and split push to his Lincolns. And in turn, it looks like it's just going to be some damage on the tier 2 in Orange's
Dire's
mid.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Dire's structures are fortified. Radiant's top tower is under attack.
So, Dire's middle tower is under attack. Some wildlings helping things out, but in the end, this tier 2
Radiant's
looks to fall.
Top tower
in turn,
has
this
fallen.
Tier 2 on top was traded out. So a nice even exchange for Orange to actually get something for
Dire's
what would have been nothing.
Tower has fallen.
So they're pretty happy about that, but we'll see if the Morana can actually force any TPs. Because as soon as somebody TPs to this position, then she's just going to leap away, and that should be obviously no kill. And if you teleport to such a defensive position, this gives Orange an opening to go in for the Roche. They've got Meld, they've got Medallion, and they really want that Aegis.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
But for now, though, Morana's not in position. We'll probably have to TP down to the bottom lane in order to find that opening. And they are still kind of flustered by this Ancient Apparition, who not only has a level 11 Ice Blast, but it's about to be agged up. He has 2,000 gold in bank. He has the components necessary. Aghanim's online at 30 minutes in the game. Very strong for Mayo. Yeah, I mean, you look at his net worth, it doesn't seem to be that threatening. 5,700 at 30 minutes, no surprise. But what he's put it into just makes such an impact on this game that they can pretty much take every fight that they want from this point forward. And the lack of pipe, gonna hurt them. The lack of mech that they could preemptively activate, gonna hurt them again. We'll see if it's going to be an uncontested Roche here. For right now, Sox is in the position just to push away, and it is going to fall very, very quickly. I don't think there's
Radiant's
any real snatch potential from
Orange,
so we just see it go down. Lifestealer free Aegis, golden experience for all of them here, but the Stampede will come through, and they'll look for an opening. Impetus strikes on Timbersaw, but they really don't get much more out of it. Sorry, Sarah, split push. Sox is split push, but as far as directly contesting any of this, not so much.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
So for now, golden experience favoring CIS significantly. 8,000 in specifically for experience. They are just doing work right now. And let's see how that translates to levels, because I can talk about those numbers all day long, but when you look at how it actually turns out, you see that not only is the Lifestealer at the top of the charts, but so are his two allies there, the Timbersaw and the CK, are just behind the Templar Assassin. So if they can just keep this momentum... Make up your mind, you say. I'm trying to follow you. Anyways, if they can just keep this pressure and momentum up, they have all the potential to end this game very shortly. They have negative armor against the Tier 3s now, with both Desolator and Assault Cross. And honestly, even with the Weave, they can still chew through their opponents. So it looks like they are going to try to force something here. They do have Aegis up on Lifestealer. He's got that big ice armor coming out from the Lich. And he's going to do a little bit of attack speed damage on the Tier 3 tower before walking away. Now again, there is split push from Orange, but just far less impactful than the damage that could break the base. So they're going to have to back soon. Back to net worth, we do see very similar story of how this game is playing out. But when it comes down to buyback, that at least that's something that Orange can be
attack.
Proud about. They do have three buybacks available. That when they commit to this fight, they can commit hard. But they're going to be fighting on even turf, as this tier 3 has been dropped down once again. And Flame is going to go in. Cancels out his Rift. Doesn't want to go too ham just yet. But they know that Morana is pushing, and they're on a timetable. Ancient Apparition going to Ice Blast, but it's going to miss completely. Just clearing out the creep wave. Now we see Sox leaping away, Stampede away, and he's going to TP home. Meanwhile, the Stampede Pursuit sets him up to bring down Lich. He'll throw out the Chain Frost, but it won't do enough. He's not even going to throw it. He's just like, okay, I'm dead. Here's a gem. And, I mean, obviously it wouldn't have done much if the Chain Frost had been thrown. So, perfectly fine for him to hold on to that for his 40-second respawn. But, for now, Orange, they have control. Once again, they get a pick. They put some damage into the Tier 3. It's not a kill in the Tier 3 like CIS got, but up against an Aegis, it's the best they can ask for.
Illusion.
So, Desolator is up for TA, but the Ice Armor is skilled up enough that it essentially nullifies it. And on top of that, like I said, most of these guys have gone for very defensive armor-based items. I mean, they're still very aggressive. They get a lot of kill potential out of this kind of set. But when you look at the armor, even without ice armor, he's running 27. So that Meld Desolator, it helps, but it's not going to be like breaking his back as far as how hard it's going to hit. He's still going to need crit or something else to actually be able to threaten this Lifestealer in the midst of the fray. Look at this farm on this timber saw. It's actually quite substantial. BOTs as well as the Bloodstone mech. Has 8 charges of that Bloodstone. So half having his respawn time and giving a nice little heal once he falls. Ice Blast will connect on mid, not really threatening anything. But we're going to see this pressure come soon, and there's absolutely no reason for them not to go. If they group up, they get the ice armor on everybody. When you just consider the raw heal potential, 250 HP heal from Mechanism, of course, maybe some earned charges thrown out. But then you look at this Bloodstone. It gets 500 HP plus 30 per charge. So that's 740 HP plus 250. Insane amount of healing. Almost 1,000 healing on all their allies. I mean, that's absolutely astounding. And of course, Ancient Aversion with his Aghanims applies the opposite effect. But now we see the Initiation Pan. They bring out Demons before that Chain Frost comes out. Once again, yes they do! Blood Chain Frost on 2. Centaur will fall. Ysera, DK beat up. Trying to deliver the damage, but look at these Phantasms. One Reality Rift. Does he have mana? No mana on the CK. He has Magic Wand. Use it! Use the Magic Wand! But no, he just wants to go in for the kills on the Rax. Reality Rift under the Tier 4 isn't going to do enough. They'll just be Shallow Grave away. Four step away from Winter, but look at that damage! The right click from Lifestealer at long range. Again, the bugging out of those melee auto attacks. But oh, Timbersaw! Big nuke! Nuclear launch detected from the Impetus, and he is going to fall. Now we're going to see the Aegis pop. Lifestealer back up at full strength is going to be able to bring down another opponent. So now two buybacks from Orange. They retreat, but they get so much out of that fight. That's 3 buybacks in total. With the Centaur, of course. Yeah. Absolutely brutal for Orange Esports. They are certainly with their backs against the wall having to expend all that gold. Like the gold graph says 7,500. You add up how much they lost from that. And almost 930 from the Centaur, 800 from the Dazzle. And the Templar Assassin also. Okay, who was the last one? I'm blind, apparently. Imrana, sorry. Soxus also spent 1,000 himself, so. Yeah, they have like an 8,000 gold lead, but that's like 11,000 when you consider how much gold was expended on top of that. The net worth graph will show that story pretty well. Even still, they've been able to control this Lich pretty well. He hasn't gotten any good Chain Frosts off, if any at all. And that means that they are able to at least have a chance at these team fights, but they get initiated on. Oh, the arrow face tanking it. June, is he going to be able to get enough damage onto Soxus? He is technically in no man's land, but as aggressive as a pursuer he may be, his team wasn't really at his side there. They'll look at Roche again, but not going to be spawning for at least 2 minutes, if not 5. Gank, flank to gank down on bottom, though. Winter in a bad spot. Does have his Force, Blink, and TP. Just going to pop his TP scroll and find his way back home. Black farms up a Reaver. Could go for the Heart, could go for the Satanic, both extremely good in this situation. And really, there's nothing to stop him at that point. He gets so tanky, either from what he's lifestealing off of or just the natural HP of the Tarrasque. He is just going to be able to control every single fight that he jumps into. And from there, all that the Orange team can really rely on is going to be Split Push. They've done a decent bit so far. They're lurking in the shadows with Ysera, and he knows exactly where his opponents are, but even still, it's a hard pill to swallow that they actually can't take a fight at this stage. So, gonna see Black moving towards the shop. He's gonna pick up the VIP booster, probably. Actually, now that I think about it, Desolator doesn't even stack with Lifesteal. What am I even talking about? So there's no reason to even contemplate anything different. I just like to actually bring into the debate a little bit of the viability of Satanic as a tank item as well as a damage item, because you get 2 hits in and you essentially get the HP you got from Heart. The only time Heart is superior is in Slow Siege, but obviously when you don't have an Orb Effect slot available, Desolator and Heart seems just a little more logical. Anywho, moving on up, we're gonna see June kind of crossing paths with Marana. Ysera does get initiation. That's great for them, but the problem is he doesn't have anything like a blink. He's just going to have to waltz up there, and there's no way they can actually catch the Timber off guard. So, a very passive game. Back and forth, a long pause at first, and now, I mean, it's a decent number of kills. It's not like 2012 Chinese Dota, but it's not the most back and forth action. We've seen a couple good fights, mostly favoring CIS. They're just waiting for their opportunity to steal the deal. I see Moonlight Shadow come out. No detection available. Sucks. Just pretty much walks away, and Templar Assassin. Sarah's still lurking. Lurk, lurk, lurk. The arrow will come out right on top of him. Almost just highlighting his position. But it's going to be Sharky to actually scout with this Moonlight. Seeing the AC aura, seeing his opponent face to face. And again, they retreat. I really feel that CIS, they have a full opening to just go aggressive, especially when this Roche respawns. But we'll see who scouts it first. If TA puts a trap in the pit, nowhere nearby, so I guess that's not going to be the case.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
In flame, actually going to get a stun out. Winter is pretty much dead. The cold feet. Yeah, he's gone. They get the ghost after, but a body block. And he's going to fall. Last right click will go to CK. He'll shatter him up. Sarah, seeing all of his opponents on the south end of the map, the eastern end, will go ahead and push out
Dire's
on the top lane.
Timsaw
truly won't be able to do much to threaten the TA's presence, but TA still doesn't feel confident pushing in, especially without a creep wave. It'll just be chewed down by the Chakram. 3-2-2, and Roche respawn. We'll see if they scout it soon.
Fallen.
It looks like it was arrowed. Not sure. But anyway, Sock's going to take some hits here. Yeah, his arrow's on cooldown for a moment longer, but look at Lifestar just going for the racks. He says, screw it. This game has gone on long enough. Black hammers away at that, and he's going to be able to bring down the melee as well. Just too much damage from these illusions from that Desolator. And of course, the AC. Meantime, TA is just kind of biding her time. Nice rage on the arrow, too. But TA is just kind of chilling out here, playing cat and mouse games with June. But the real fight's going to happen down here. 2-3 drops down, black on the racks. They have to draw the line at some point. Draw a line in the sand. Show them what you're worth. But right now, the Pop of Moonlight Shadow. The Weave needs to come out. Finally on his opponents. I get two in the Weave, but Inflame just pops the BKB, and they can just TP away. They got what they came for. They got three racks. They lost nothing. And at best, now Orange gets a kill plus a Roche. Demon's in a bad spot. Will throw out the Chain Frost and Insidious Sea, but that's going to hit on the creep wave, and that's about it. So they'll evaporate the Lich, now pursuing onto June. He's got plenty of trees between. Oh, nice done by Winter. Maybe not. He has plenty of trees to try to speed him away, but they seem to be willing to pursue. June running very low on mana. Might just have to suicide with the Bloodstone. Just after first. In the end, it looks like. Wow, really?
Where are you going?
They're going to turn their attention to the double damage Lifestealer, who just goes ahead and rages. Oh, wounds! Met by a Ghost Scepter, but turns his attention to Ysera. Refraction gone. 3 seconds later, Ice Blast on the City of C. He's going to TP home, though. And I think he'll survive. It's hard to tell with that ultimate. Depends on the rank, really. At max rank, I think he would die, but he's going to live. And Ysera will pop the BKB to get out of dodge. CK, unable to find his prey, but now they'll just rotate and find one more Rax on top of the mini they've already found. Now we see some damage coming in. Oh, nice Phantasm dodge of Winter's stun. They even pull him back into it and try to bring him down, but Stampede is a little too strong. We look to Enchantress. Aghanim's Scepter, Mask of Madness. Tons of potential here, but they don't have the opening. The stuns were dodged, and suddenly their Rax evaporates once again. Now, I will note that Insidious is using his enchant on these CK illusions, allowing him to actually steal them for his own purposes. But they find the Roche, finally knowing that it spawned. This is pretty much the 11-minute mark, so they knew it was up, guaranteed. They walk, waltz right in, and take what's theirs. Cheese and Aegis in CIS's hands. They have a 4-rex advantage. It's almost impossible to come back from this. So, Cheese on June can make good use of that mana here. And, of course, the Aegis is going to go to the CK this time. Since the Lifestar just doesn't have item slots to spare, he's about to upgrade to BOTs and turn the drums into, I don't know, whatever he wants. Mjolnir is always fun, and that is an orb that doesn't have a problem with stacking, because it only overrides it when it procs. The crit is also really, really good.
Allies disappear.
But no matter what he chooses, He's in a pretty good position here. Now we see the initiation. Del Black raging out of Winter's stun. He's gonna pop the Ghost Scepter while in flame. Just gets dropped to smithereens. Gonna be able to come back up with the Aegis though, but I don't know if he can. No, he will have the detection to get the Templar Assassin with that Reality Rep Refraction though. Keeping her up, she'll just stand and delivery. Sarah gonna be able to kill off Inflame before falling herself. Now slowing down on Socks. Arrow won't do much, and they will be able to kill off two. Buyback from the CK, they're looking to end this now. But coming in, big damage coming in. Winter gonna drop very soon if he's not careful, but he has enough HP to persist, and they don't get any more damage on him. So they're able to bring down the Ancient Apparition. The Dazzle will fall. The Centaur doesn't look like he will. He has a lot of HP, but 12% is still pretty far away.
Dire's top tower has fallen.
So they need one more hit from the Timber from the CK, who were approaching from mid lane, but they didn't get the hit, so. Winter lives. We'll see if he can do anything with it.
Dire's top tower
15 seconds of Stampede. Attack. They pull the creeps away. A lot of mega creeps from bottom and mid. But the final Rax is what they have to defend. Winter goes in once again, but look at how fast he drops! One rage from Black and a quick right click brings him down. Now Isera's gone as well. They don't even need Chain Frost to win this game. GG is called, and the second game of this best of two is in the books, ladies and gentlemen. CIS Gaming. They take it home. Very smooth move. They get some much needed points in the WPC Ace, and things are looking bad for Orange. They, of course, have a triple header today, so two more best of two matches up against the Chinese Giants, but CIS send them packing for their round one. So just to tally up the totals, LGD have lost one game to Orange, so they got 1 point yesterday, but they haven't gotten anything today, and we're going to be going into game two with them thirsty for some blood. If I have to give a quick analysis as far as where things went wrong, I didn't like the movement of Dazzle and Enchantress early so much. Some of it was just creep RNG, and you can't do much about that. Other bets were just, they were trying to gank heroes that weren't really that gankable. Anyways, the last bit I'll have to say is that Soxus, something had to change about that top lane, because a 414 GPM Mirana is not going to cut it against these types of farmers. Anyways, that's my two cents going into game, or not game two, we're going into the next match in just a few minutes here. We are a little bit behind schedule, so I assume we're going to jump on it immediately, but it's going to be Orange versus Newbie, and it's scheduled for 6 minutes from now. So 2:30 Pacific Daylight Time, that's 5:30 by me. And we'll jump into that in just a few minutes. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Once again, shout out to Beyond the Summit for giving me the opportunity to cast for them while they're sleeping the night off, getting ready for the qualifiers in the next few days. And shout out to you viewers for sticking with me through that extensive pause and some goofy lore reading. Final thing I'll mention is that if you guys did enjoy the commentary, you can always follow me and show some support via twitter.com/blazecasting. You can also just throw some constructive criticism at me, especially if you didn't like the casting, and just help me improve and try to bring you guys the best commentary I can. Like I said, I'm CIS. I was a little shaky on because I mostly cast Southeastern Asian Dota over on Dota Talk TV 2, but I'm doing the best I can, and hopefully we get some great games for me to commentate in the next few hours. So going into Newbie versus Orange in just a few minutes. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll catch you guys on the next one.